We're talking on our Chalk Talk today about time management. We come back to this topic a couple times a year, sometimes three times a year, because it really, really, really matters. There are 5 points to this, and my assistant for the show is going to be Mahatma Gandhi. He's a pretty smart dude and must have known a lot about time and his time. So here we go. Your life, you have a lot of things to do. If there were 8 days in a week or 26 hours in a day, you'd probably find ways to fill them up with activities. There seems to be never quite enough time. And here's the troika of responsibility. You've got work, you've got life, and you've got home, and it's time involved in all of those little things, little areas of our life. Is there a relationship between these two things? Time and money. Certainly there is. A big relationship between the two of those things. There is only so much of this stuff. It's probably the most precious resource on the planet. Some people might think it's oil. I think it's water. I think it's time. There's only so much time. Every week, you have 168 hours. That's all there are, 168 hours. And you need to use some of those for sleeping, and you need to use some of those for lots of other reasons. But 168 hours, that's all we have. And there's a daily dilemma. There's what am I going to do right now, and what am I going to do in the future? And should I stop what I'm doing now to think about the future, or should I let the future take care of itself, and so on and so forth? No matter how much, the more work you have to do, the inspiration for that work goes down. You've all experienced that, I presume. Inspiration goes down as work to do goes up, because this can become overwhelming, and then you just want to go home and sleep all the time. Understand this. Successful, happy, prosperous people do very many of the same things that you do, but they do them a little bit differently. They don't do them exactly in the same way. And successful, happy, prosperous people use their time far, far better than those who don't. One of the tricks to becoming a good at business is to understand how to use that time wisely. I'm glad to hear that one of us is taking Friday, Saturday, and Sunday off, because it's really important to do that. You know that you will burn out if you do not do that. The goal of time management, surprisingly enough, is to do less rather than more. Some people think it might be to do more. No, it's the objective is to do less, not more. So, point number one of the 5 points. First point is block out a schedule. By that I mean schedule your time and energy and work and live within identified, purpose-driven blocks of time. This is Done Business Strategy number 7 in the book. That's the book. I've Got What You Want, A Well-Done Business. It says here, Story of Enlightenment and Transformation. It says below that, how Fred Cooper, a character I invented in the story, found prosperity and lasting contentment. The book is available to you. If you send me an email, I'll send it to you. It's free. It's an electronic book. You can read it at your leisure. And Done Business Strategy number 7 is in that book. Done Business Strategy number 7 says this stuff right here. We have 4 kinds of ways you can use time. Each one has a special usage and a special name. The first one is called prep time. It's getting ready to do things. It's planning time. The second one is called show time. That's money making and prep and production time. That's doing your top money making activities time. The third one is detail time. That's wrapping up, completing projects already started, and taking care of paperwork and so forth and so on. And the fourth kind is called free time. Now, each of those kind of times I'm going to describe for you in a little bit of detail with a slide for each one of them. Let's start with prep time. Prep time periods are for setting up spectacular show time periods. You spend time today thinking of all those appointments you're going to have tomorrow and getting ready for those appointments and setting up those appointments. For when you have those appointments tomorrow, the preparation has already been done. That's why I said the word for today is preparation. They're for planning and scheduling. They're for assigning tasks to other people, that is delegating. And therefore, anything else that needs to be done. That's what prep time periods are for. And they have to be scheduled on your calendar or they will not happen. I believe of the 4 kinds of time, this one's the most important. If you get this right, the other 3 kinds seem to flow much, much more effectively. Showtime periods are for making money. They're for making money and selling and closing deals and making money and selling and closing deals. They're for talking to people, schmoozing with people about money-making things, about appointments that are important to you and so forth. They're about producing results. They're about building key relationships with those with whom you network, with key clients, key customers. If you have an insurance agency and you have 4, 5, 6 really, really key big insurance clients, you should spend some time with those people other than once a year. So you need to go take them out to lunch, find out about their children and the things that are interesting to them. And we've talked about this, and we're doing this kind of stuff. It's important. It matters. It's about making more money and more sales. I said that twice, didn't I? Yes, because that's really important. It's top money-making activity time, which means you need clarity about what are your top money-making activities. Well, they're this and this and this, but they're not this and this and this. That's low priority stuff. This is high priority stuff. Low priority stuff, high priority stuff. And it's also for doing the work for which people pay you. Eventually, that's necessary. They've given you the money. Now you got to give the talk, make the bed, sell the house, whatever it is that you're doing. And these times also must be scheduled on your calendar. Detail times then are for handling details. It's by definition. The word says speaks for itself. Dealing with paperwork, handling data, dealing with leftovers, analyzing results, and again, doing anything else that needs to be done. And you need to have these in your schedule as well. Then, free time is for resting and recuperating and rejuvenating and enjoying, having fun, not working. That means when you go to Hawaii on your vacation, you don't take your cell phone and your files and decide you're going to spend some time doing some work in Hawaii, because it ruins the vacation. Vacation is different. It's for enjoying your family and your friends and having fun, not working, and these two need to be scheduled. Most people have one called Saturday and Sunday. Some people have one called Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. Some people have one called Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. You're looking at one of those. I'm a Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday weekend guy. I hardly do anything on Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, except what I want. I sleep, I play with my computer. I don't see clients usually on those days. So it's all work and all play will drive you nuts. Right, Aaron? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. Now, Gandhi says showtime, prep time, detail time, and free time blocks will only work when you schedule them into your calendar. So you've got to open up your calendar, and you've got to say, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, those are good times for showtime. Mondays, that's a really good time for prep time. Friday, that's a really good time for detail time, or whatever the last day of the week is for you. And you block them out. And you don't let other things interfere with those times, because they're as important as your most important clients. Point number two, work on priorities. To win, you got to first know what matters. That's important. And you got to start by knowing where to put that precious time and energy that you have, because you only have so much. Now here's a jar that has some little bitty rocks in it. We're calling these priorities in this little jar. Is the jar full? No. We could add some pebbles to the jar. Is it full then? No. We could add some sand. Still not full. We can add water. Now it's full. Can't put anything else in there. But can you get to the priorities? No. It's got a lot of stuff in the way. And if you dump it out on the table to get to their priorities, they're all dirty and covered up with sand and water and such and such. You don't want that. Keep the jar free of unimportant matters, things other people ought to do, things that can be done later, not on a peak time. And stop wasting time on all that crappy stuff that's not a high priority, or you'll never get your high priority stuff done. And you'll be wondering, you'll be driving home on Friday saying, how come I spent all week again and didn't get to those high priority things? Because you didn't plan it out in advance. So put the priorities in first and then align those with your intentions. Okay? Now, the thing about priorities is you don't have a jar full, you've got buckets of them. And they're kind of heavy. And your priorities have a life of their own. They really do, those little devils. And they're very shifty and they're always moving around. You can't hardly sometimes pin them down, right? So you want to work on your actual, real priorities. Identify them, get them under your control, put them where you can see them. Don't stack them up in a corner and just forget about them or leave them there. That guy's got too many priorities anyway. And create a system to work on those priorities and work on them one at a time. If you multitask, you'll go crazy. You won't get as much done. You'll wonder why I'm wasting all this time and energy. I'm busy, but I'm not getting anything done because you're multitasking. Making the priorities work means these things. It means doing whatever it takes to make new money come into your enterprise. That's what working the priorities means. It means keeping in touch with your biggest customers and demonstrating appreciation to them so they will come back and so they will refer to you and speak highly of you. That's important. It means doing the work for which you get paid and doing it properly and effectively and right. It means keeping everybody on the same page because you do talk about what's important. You do talk about mission. You do talk about goals. You do talk about vision. You don't keep that stuff secret. And it means adjusting and reprioritizing constantly because you have to. And nothing stays the same for very long. Point number three, deflect the urgent. If you have not read this book, please get this book. You can buy it used for probably a buck. The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People by Stephen Covey. I think it was written in 1985 or 86. I've read my copy so many times there's hardly anything left of it. Covey says there is a big difference between important things and urgent things. Things that are important and things that are urgent. He describes that as this in this way. The difference being that important things are the priorities. They lead to goals. They lead to cash money. They lead to fame, if that's what you're seeking. They lead to buying power, more of that, because you have more money, and the good life that comes along with that. Those are the important things. The urgent things are maybe time sensitive and stressful, but they lead nowhere in terms of goals and priorities and so forth and so on. Yes, I have to go buy the dry cleaners to pick up my suit on the way home, but it's urgent. I need that part of the morning, but doesn't have anything to do with what I want to do tomorrow morning except be wearing my nice suit. So often, and more often than you would probably care to admit, that's a choice. Whether you decide to work with priorities and do things that are important lead to goals, or whether you decide to do things that are not urgent and let yourself be distracted into things that might be fun, might be things you need to do, but they're not related to goals. So we need to do less of that. Urgent. Truly urgent. That's truly urgent. You cannot avoid the fact that the railroad car fell off the track. That's a true urgent thing. Many of the other things that we think are urgent are not urgent, not like that. Now here's a matrix that's in the book that Covey wrote that I've adapted a little bit. Q1, quadrant one, is urgent and important. This is the crisis zone. This is where distractions lie. This is where there's a rush of stuff. This is where you're stressed out. Covey says you can expect to spend maybe 20 to 30% of your time there. Now what if you're an emergency room technician? Or what if you work in an emergency room? You can expect to spend 100% of your time there because that's the nature of your job. But most of us don't do that. If you're a fireman, when the bell rings, you're spending 100% of your time there. If you're a policeman driving around, you probably spend a lot more time than 20% of your time doing that. Now, not urgent, but important, quadrant three. This is the good quadrant, true. This is the good quadrant. This is money-making zone. Things you plan for, things that are done while you're kind of relaxed and in control, and you should spend 60 to 80% of your time there. You'll see in a moment that these statistics don't add up to 100%. There's more than 100%. This is the distraction zone. This is not important, but urgent. It's not important, but it's urgent. Okay. Interruptions, some fun stuff, 15% of your time to spend down here. This I call stupid zone. Covey didn't call it stupid zone. I call it stupid zone. This is not important and it's not urgent. You shouldn't spend any time there at all. I've been to people's offices. I will not name names. They've never been a member of this program. And they're sitting there watching soap operas on their television sets. Big screen TV. And I've been there 2 or 3 times and they always got the soap operas going if it's that time of the day. Why do they do that? They sit there watching the soap operas. It's not urgent and it's not important. They got to keep in touch with their soaps. They got to keep up on it.
Yeah.
I here are all four of them together. You see the times do add up to more than 100%. So that's the best place. Not urgent, but important. Plan for it, money making, so on and so forth. And how can you win with that time since you've only got so much? Where does that extra time come from? It can only come from down here. You got to take from down here and go up there. That's the trick with this thing that Covey just showed us. Take from not distraction, from urgent but not important, and put it up to not urgent and important. That's the only way to win with this system. Okay? How do you do that? Gandhi tells us there's the four D's. The four D's help us do that. First D is distractions. Minimize distractions. Tell people, when you see me in my office with the door shut, leave me alone. If I tell you I'm going to be busy for a while and the phone rings and not to interfere with me a phone, don't send that phone call to me. I don't want to hear it. I'm busy doing what? Money-making activities. Well, what if that person who says, well, I want to distract you as your client, say, I might be working on something important to you, so don't distract me. So D is the first one. Delegate is the second one. Second D is find somebody else who can do it. What should you be delegating? Everything that you can possibly think of that you can delegate. Keep your genius level stuff. Delegate all routine and boring matters to others. It's hard to do that because why? Well, because they won't do it as well as I do it. We know this is true. They won't do it as well as you do it until you train them and teach them how to do it. It takes them a while to learn. So put them on it, they'll make mistakes, and they'll get better at it. That's the second one, delegate. Third one is delay. Don't do it in the peak time, in your showtime period. Do it when you've got other things not to do. Do it on a Friday or do it on a Monday afternoon. Do it during a prep time or during a detail time. And the last one is the simplest one, just don't do it. So also learn to do this. I mean, how many times do people call you up and say, oh, we got a board meeting, would you like to come to one of our board meetings? We need a new person, you'd be great on our board, and you say yes. No, you got to say no. I don't want to be on your board. I've got other things I need to do. Particularly when you get to be, when people retire, they get all these calls. You should come and work on it for our nonprofit. We need you on our board of directors. You got some good financial savvy. You'll be great for us. No, 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 or you have no life. So learn to say no to yes. Again, if you can do that, you can get 2, 3, 4 more hours of high productivity per week. How much is that worth to you? And what do you lose by getting rid of this stuff? Nothing. Not really. Nothing. Okay. Number four. Point number four. Do the hard stuff first. Have you heard of this guy, Brian Tracy? He writes a lot of business books about how to be more productive in achievement. He wrote this book called Eat the Frog, Eat That Frog, 21 Ways to Stop Procrastinating and Get More Done in Less Time. He says the frog is your biggest, most important task. It might not be pleasant, but it's the biggest, most important task. So do that first. And what if you have two really, really ugly frogs sitting in front of you, then eat the ugliest one, uglier one first. Get it over with. Do the really hard stuff to do first. Get it done. Work from hard towards easy, not from easy towards hard. Because if you work from easy towards hard, you'll stop. It's too hard. I'll do it tomorrow. I'll do it the next week. Here's from Tracy's book. He says, set the table. In other words, get ready, prepare yourself. Plan each day in advance. So if this were a work day, you'd plan tomorrow, today. Consider the consequences of everything you're thinking about. Well, this might work, this might work, this might work, this has got a problem over here. Identify the key constraints and figure out ways to overcome them. Put some pressure on yourself. One of the reasons why people become more effective before they get on vacation is because they're going on vacation. I've got to get such and such done because, by golly, I'm going on vacation. I've got the tickets. I'm going to go. So imagine you're going to leave town next week, and what you do this will be more effective right now. Slice and dice the task. Put it in small pieces, doable, chewables. Get it down to manageable pieces. Whatever you do, as soon as you get ready to take action immediately. Don't put it off. Do not fail to act. You've done all the rest of the stuff. Then you just say, well, okay, I'm going to go home. No, do the work. And one from Richard. Do the term paper on Monday. Remember when you were in school? And you got a term paper, a book report, and you put it off, and you put it off, and you put it off, and you put it off. 6, 8 weeks later, 10, 12 weeks later, you're doing it at the middle of the night. I was the guy who did it as soon as I got the assignment.
hated you.
I was that guy.
You got beat up a lot.
I didn't have a lot of friends in school, but I had a lot of easy times. Because
yeah.
I'm going to do it eventually. I may as well get it over with. That's what I did. So it didn't hurt anybody. Point number five, schedule your distractions. You're going to have distractions. You may as well count on them and schedule them. So look, a distraction is coming. Yes, we are addicted to distractions. Distractions give us a little adrenaline jump. How many times have you been sitting across with somebody at a coffee shop or a restaurant having a meaningful conversation, and you'll suddenly see them look over to the side because someone walked by and they wanted to see who that was? We like that stuff. It gives us a little jolt. So it's going to happen. Distractions and such are diversions. They're taking us away from being in the moment. Look at this one. She's probably watching television instead of watching what she's doing. That's not so bad, but this is. She's about to put the mixer down and grind up that goldfish. That's not good. And, you know, distractions, just another meaningless message to keep you from paying attention to all the issues that really matter. That's what distractions are. And, you know, this one doesn't matter much either. There's not much consequences to spilling the sugar all over the counter, but there might be some serious distractions to that one. Texting or making a phone call while driving, and she's not looking at the road. She's looking down here. That could...
1985 cell phone.
Yeah, she's got an old cell phone. But that's not good. Hey, I got one of those. I would put a picture here, but it would just distract her. So I didn't do that. Distractions will happen. Schedule. I had a client here in town who had a help desk business where he had about 85 people working for him who were college students, and they were helping people get on connected to the internet and working on software programs. And when he would come back from lunch, he would tell me, "Richard, I'm just inundated by distractions. As soon as I walk in at that particular time after lunch, people are all over me with problems and problems and problems that they should be able to solve themselves." I said, "No kidding." He says, "Yeah, what can I do?" I said, "Schedule those distractions." He says, "What do you mean?" He says, "Tell people that you'll be available for lunch, after lunch, every day for 30 minutes. That's it. You're going to schedule them after lunch. No other time am I able to be distracted. Do not distract me in the morning. Do not distract me after that 30-minute period after lunch. That's when you can distract me. Line up outside my door if you wish. Argue amongst yourselves which one has the major, biggest need to see me, and put that person up in the front of the line." And that worked for him. Gave him control over his time for the first time in years. Discuss distractions. Okay, we have 5 points. First, block out a schedule. 4 kinds of time. Second, work on those priorities. 1 minute. Third, deflect the urgent. Then do the hard stuff first. And last, schedule those distractions.